Okay.
Yeah.
This will be a second lecture about Schur-Weyl duality. I'll try to give some last time, but it's better to give the definition now. And the group algebra that we are interested in is the group algebra of the symmetric group. And I'll leave some more details about the presentation of the symmetric group. And then I'll leave a counterpart of the double centralizing theorem, but for the group algebra this time. And then we will introduce the Schur functors. Okay, so that's a tentative plan. If we have any group and any field, for instance, you can take real numbers, complex numbers, you can take prime characteristics if you like, but for our application we'll mostly use the complex numbers. But from any group at any group G, you can organize the space KG, which is the space of linear combination spanned on the values with elements in the group G. Okay, so, and then this base can be endowed with the structure of an algebra just by multiplying, extending the product of the linear extension of the product on the group. So if you have multiplication of two linear combinations with basis elements in the group G, with some coefficients which are in the field K, then the result is just an element in G, which is the multiplication J and H, so new element in G, and then a new coefficient which comes from the summation of the coefficients here. So, you can change your summation indices, so you get here the new coefficient, and this is the element of the basis in the summation. And, I use this implicitly, but let us stress this now. If you have a representation of the group G, it is the same as to have representation, linear representation in some space which is over the field in question. Okay, then it is the same to say that you have a representation of G and B, or I have a KJ module. So, here is the demonstration. Just see if you have one element which is staying in KG, multiplying an element this is the KG module set. It is the same. You can, of course, act with G on your V, and then summate over the coefficients. So here you use the structure presentation G and V. It's a linear space, so we can summate. So we distinguish KJ model for linear representation of V of G in a vector space with coefficient K. So and, I will successively use in class time SN models, which in this context should be the same as representations of the symmetric group with elements in complex representation. Okay, well, I guess this may be very well known, but we'll be on the safe side, let us mention it again. Do you hear me well? Just to see the... Is everything okay with the video and the...
The minimal ideals will correspond to the Eurasian
facing all the present patients. I hope that you feel this notion. And, okay, and then if you have a right ideal of the rank, it will arise when you fit your rank with the idempotent acting on the other side, on the left hand side. Maybe this is very common. So when you have a right model, you just obtain it by having an idempotent or projector which is projecting from your regular presentation into the idea. So, but if the idea is right hand side, you have to fit your if you have a right action, you have to fit your rank with the idempotent on the other hand side. Okay, so well, let us suppose that we have many ideals. And, well, okay, minimal ideas, ideas. So, this will give you, the composition into, the space of ideals. And then the ring will be semi-simple when you have, direct sub. And when, so to have the direct sub, it will be equivalent to a system of a set of idempotents which are orthogonal to each other. So the orthogonality is written here. So if you have an ideal and you hit it by the projector corresponding to the another ideal, you project a zero. And this actually this projection will be equivalent to that simple real. So ij delta ij stands for chronic here. So if you have two projectors with different ij, you'll get simply zero, and you'll have the same, you'll get the idempotency condition. And well, now if you are with your ring, you can have such a system, and such a system is complete when you can decompose the unit element into a sum of, it's called also partition of unity, a sum of projectors. And well, to have, once again, to have such a decomposition, such a use, it should be equivalent. Equivalent to the decomposition to the same, to the decomposition which is here. So one can say that we are dealing with primitive idempotents, which means that no idempotent could be further decomposed, and that's reflecting the condition of irreducible idempotence. Okay. Do you have some question for the time being? keep going. So, well, let us take now one module. Well, let us take a module which respect to our ring or group algebra, and imagine that it's a semi-simple module, so we have the decomposition into irreducibles. And now let us consider the endomorphisms of this model. So, well, let us take different spaces here, irreducible spaces, and let's draw the arrows. So this will be the homomorphism from different representations. And well, when I have homomorphism from I to J, I just call this, when I have this flash, I call this an elephant, AJR, here. Well, you consider for any couple of indices, you consider this arrow. Okay, and so this element is in the endomorphism here. Now, imagine that you have a composition, you have two elements like here, which meets on a common element G, so this is, you have also operation, a composition of arrows. So, well, this is some operation in the algebra of arrows, if you like. And then let us consider the projection or algebraic which you see as an element from M to some subspace here, an R. And well, it's projecting on the component, and it has a huge kernel which consists of all elements which are not in MR. That's the definition of the projection. And then the decomposition here will be equivalent to the following complete set of idempotents. When you have, again, this is the orthogonality condition for projectors, and that condition that all these endomorphisms, if you like, some of the identity endomorphism. Okay, what is this one? And okay, so now let us give a name S to S from semi-sample maybe to this algebra that you have here. Then, I will use this tautology because this is the identity element here, this is the identity element. I can rewrite as a such a sum with some projection both sides. And I can reorganize it. Well, I have again the indices IJ running from 1 to K. But see that now the sum is not the, it's not just the sum of spaces, but this is direct sum, meaning that these spaces have no intersection. And well, here I'll try to write just to see is it a good idea, can be allowed. So why here we have a direct space? Look, if you have such an element and okay. Oh, it's not that simple, but let me try. Okay. So, well, if you have such an element and so this is one element in the space here, and I can multiply it by another element. So let us say see that this here is simply the idempotent, so of AJ in the middle I have just E, so EJ. Okay, and then multiply by S. The whole element is again an element in S. So we got a new element. The idea is to say that this quantities here is multiplied just like matrix units. When you have a common index, then you have a new element within R and K. This here is the holos. But imagine that you have J and J prime, which are different, and then because of the orthogonality, you get simply zero. So, well, I wanted to stress that you have here a structure of matrix units. You can compare this with the matrix which are everywhere zero and only with elements everywhere zero and one onto one place, intersection of in the column A and the row G. Okay, is that rings the bell? So, well, that's this, if you have a particular case when the module is not whatever, but just you are in the regular representation, so R is acting on itself, and you can ask the question what if you have a right action on the right regular representation, then you can ask the question, what is the centralizer? Centralizing action in the regular representation, and maybe this can be a small homework, try to figure out why you have this. R opposite is just the same at the same group algebra in which the element the order of the element is the opposite. They are multiplied on the if you have B times A in the opposite algebra, it is by definition A times B in the usual. So okay. Let us continue. So now I just said that you have some structure of matrix algebra, so let us see that we are dealing with block matrices. It is something that I used last time, so I decided that maybe it was too fast, so I'll go again. So if you have in your decomposition that all the models are isomorphic to one and the same module, then you can write that the whole M, remember that you have k copies in your decomposition, so all of them are isomorphic to one and the same. So, then the whole is isomorphic. The multiplicity I can put here or there. So that's one notation for the multiplicity. I think we use it already. And what will be the endomorphism for this huge chain? It will be just, you have k copies here and k copies there in the target, in the source and in the target. So by using, if you like, Schur lemma for any of this, and moreover, I want M to be irreducible. So then this basic algorithm is this algebra is equivalent to a block k by k. And actually, we were using the general case when, if you have the composition of a module into submodules which are irreducible but non-equivalent, and each of them appears with different multiplicities, which actually here, then the space of endomorphisms will have the same the following block structure. So this should be thought as a big. So if here you have a matrix everywhere zero for the elements and somewhere one, all others zero, so you have k square elements. And that matrix here will correspond to a block structure. And the size, each block size, the relative size will be h1, h2, and so on. And so, zero starts. And, well, we will be interested to see what is the structure when R is the group algebra of the symmetric group, if this is the object that we were dealing with. Okay, some question?
Here
the lengths. So if you have one permutation, it can be decomposed into, or decomposed, maybe not the good word, but it could be brought into cyclic notation, which contains the cycles different lengths, and so the elements which are in one conjugacy class have the same structure of cycles. So, well, that's the idea why this decomposition appear here. And the other object which we need here is some filling of the Young diagram, and these fillings are called standard tableaus. So, well, they are increasing fillings on rows and columns. So, for instance, for the simplest one, you have these two possibilities, and for this one, you have three possibilities. All others are forbidden because you cannot, you have to increase here. And then, well, all these tableaus are, all these students are called standard tableau. And, well, there's one which is not better than the others, but is somehow referred. And as it will play some role, we'll call it canonical, even though it's not really canonical. So one, it's just one of this. So, well, this is when you number your rows one after the other, starting from the top row. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and then number 5, 6, 7. So this is the code of, you have altogether 9. So this is some addition of 9. And this is one of the possible standard tableau, which is called canonical. And now, let us look at the idempotents again, but with a little bit finer structure. We are not only using the Young tableau, but not only the diagram, but the tableau. So, well, what I'm writing here, you have, again, the symmetric permutation of n elements, and to every filled diagram, you have a tableau, and you can associate to this tableau some subgroup which is somehow permuting the elements which are in the rows. This is the per in the rows in the tableau, which is here. And you can write another subgroup which is permuting the elements which are, let me look here. So if I have the PT, if I have the element, I want to write happened. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I think I can.
Yes, I'm really sorry. We cannot connect to the server.
Oh, I don't know. It's but yeah, they can hear you.
I don't see that this is so. Let me see how
we can do.
I don't see anything. I have a message.
It's okay.
I keep going. Very good. I can have a screen which is missing. Well, see, if I have a permutation from one the elements from 1 to 9, which is turning inside of the elements from which second elements which are here, permuting elements here, there and there on the lines, but not the elements in between, this will be an example for some subgroup. And if I have another, so given a tableau, given a diagram on the tableau, I have some subgroup which is preserving the rows here, and I have another which is preserving the columns, and well, that's a bit like cooking book recipe. But one can prove it will take too much time. So I'm not doing this now, and I can do it another time. You can, for every tableau, you can construct one ident, which I'll call the unit identity. So given standard Yang tableau, I introduced some two elements which are where they are living. These elements, they are living in the group algebra because I have combinations, linear combination of the elements of the group with some coefficient. The coefficient is it's 1, 1, 1, and then you have an overall normalization. So, well, to the subgroup, to the row subgroup, you perform something which is here you see that it's something like symmetrization, and to the columns you put into correspondence something which is anti-symmetrization. You're somehow symmetrizing on rows and anti-symmetrizing on columns, and then you multiply these two elements in the group algebra. They are again in the group algebra, and so this is a new element in the group algebra, and by some profound reasons, it's an identity. Well, up to normalization, this is a factor, so we can renormalize it in order to fulfill that to be identical. And well, and you have something more, that if you have different tableaus, you have orthogonality. Let me look, for instance, let me think that I have some two elements which correspond to different tableaus here. Well, it maybe it will be not so easy to see, but just roughly, you have symmetrization followed by anti-symmetrization. And see that here I have some place I have symmetrization, and then I have to follow it by anti-symmetrization. So before us, and then I have some other more complicated. But if I have to symmetrize, anti-symmetrize from the same indices, it will give zero. And so, going a little bit in front, I'm showing that, well, I'm not showing, I'm telling you this, how is it, that you have a system which is system of orthogonal idempotents, which are labeled by standard tableaus, and every standard tableau. So for every standard tableau, you have an index A for the standard tableau, and a lambda is the shape of the tableau, so the frame. And so you have idempotent if the tableau and the shape are the same. But you can have the same shape, the same length diagram, and different length tableaus, and this element, and this will be orthogonal projectors. So, for instance, here I have one projector, here I have another, and they correspond to the same diagram, but which is here, that you have two different projectors, and how you have primitive, which are labeled by the information is in the young tableau. Okay. And then the important here, the importance of the idempotent is for the construction of irreducible representation as a subspace of the group algebra. So I have the group algebra. I can take the regular representation, and I want to take the ideals in the regular representation considered as a right model, the same model. So I multiply by my projectors on the left, and for every standard tableau I have one projector, they are all orthogonal, and so I have a reducible representation. Now here there is a subtlety that you have different tableau which give different but isomorphic representations. So you have orthogonal projectors which give you different submodels, but nevertheless these different submodels are isomorphic. And well, it turns out that the information into the tableau is so all representation which correspond to the same diagram will be isomorphic. So same diagram but different tableaus will give you isomorphic representatives. So, well, situation, then you prefer to choose one copy of this and to say that this will be your representative. So to choose one copy is to, you can say, well, I'll fix my standard tableau, and then all other representation which have different tableaus but with the same shape will be isomorphic. So if I fix, I give the name set to the one of the projectors with this canonical standard tableau that I fixed before, then I'll somehow run somehow fix this arbitrariness. And now, well, as I said already, you have again system of orthogonal identicals. They sum all these different identicals. So you have double sum. One is of the standard tableau, and another one, it is on the diagrams, in the different diagrams. So if you are working with your group Sn, n is fixed. So you choose first all different decomposition, so partitions of n, which is all different n diagrams, empty, and then all different headings, which are the semi-standard, and then the sum of all this should be one. So, well, and if you have such a system of idempotents, then you can decompose your regular representation, so it as a right module. So you fit here. I just rewrite this by using that identity. Is such a sum. And now for every model here, I take one representative which was the one with the fixed identifier. So what I get is this chosen representative here, which appears with multiplicity. And the multiplicity is equal to the number of the standard tableaus with given shape. Just because here somehow the summation on T is redundant as far as I have the same frame. So the sum on different standard tableau gives me the multiplicity. So the repeating representation which are isomorphic. I have many which goes to one. And this many appears here as multiplicity. And the number of the standard tableau gives you the multiplicity. So this is a decomposition of the group algebra. Well, now this we have already seen for the particular case, symmetrization and symmetrization. And well, let us see now the structure. Let us consider the group algebra, the symmetric group, and I'll take it as a bimodule, so you can consider one action on right and another on the left. So my idea is to apply the double centralizer theorem when I have the group algebra itself, and I don't have different actions, I have right and left action again in the same ring. So you have three times one and the same. You have the group algebra once as a vector space on which you act by symmetric group on the right or on the left. And, well, what will be the, if I take the right action here, what will be the centralizer of the regular representation? That's the notation. What will be the centralizer of the regular representation? Well, by general wisdom, it is just the opposite ring. And, well, but the opposite ring of, if you have the opposite of the algebra, if you take your permutation group and you take the inverse of the elements, in the inverse, the order of the elements is reversed. So, taking the inverse on the basis on the group algebra is giving the isomorphism between the opposite group algebra and the initial one, which is taken here. And so, the centralizer of the regular representation will be again equivalent to the representation itself. I put here for R, I put the decomposition that I got before, the decomposition from there. Well, and again, by this simple fact, for the block structure, so you have one and the same representation, and you get here the block structure, and the size of the block is equal to the multiplicity, which is equal to the number of standard tableaus. Well, so this is one. This is something new because we got the block structure of the group algebra. And let us put one more structure, or let us look this from the perspective of the double centralizer theorem. So we take it as the group algebra as a bimodule, and then see that if you remember the construction, you decompose your group algebra into all possible irreducible representations, and then you put here a space which is accounting for the multiplicities. So the whole trick is to realize that you can put more than putting just the multiplicities as number. You can categorify this number, which is the dimension of some vector space. So you can, instead of working with multiplicity numbers, you work with multiplicity space, and on this multiplicity space you have even more structure. So when you consider SN as a bimodal, you can decompose it into this S lambda state stands for the right module, which you introduce, and this stands for the complicity multiplicity space, which is by definition written here. But you can look this the other way around. You can say, well, because this model is just a conjugation, so this definition of the multiplicity space is also the definition of the dual model. And if you have a dual of a right model, you get a left model. So here you have something more. If you start from looking at SN as a left model, you say you have the S left models here with the star, and then S lambda will be the multiplicity space for this star. So this S lambda could be thought as a double star, if you like. And see that the decomposition was written before. So instead of having here this F lambda as dimension, now I have a whole space. But this space is taking into account the structure of my module already, because these are, once again, these are right models of SN, and these are left models of SN. So I have a decomposition of the group algebra into the my module. And maybe this implies, maybe you have seen a combinatorial formula. If I take the number of elements on the left-hand side and the right-hand side, here how many elements I have. And factorial, the number, the dimension of this space of the group algebra. It has a basis. That is given by the elements of SN, so it's n factorial. And here, for any of this, I have dimension. You can read it here, or can read it here. So these are the blocks of size F lambda. And then I sum over all different Young tableaus. So, this decomposition implies combinatorial, one combinatorial formula, which gives you the size of the blocks. So if you have, this is, I'll try to So if you have three factorial, it's equal to 1 plus, oh sorry, 1 plus 4 plus 1, 6. This is sum of squares, 1 plus 4 plus 1. So this will imply that the decomposition of CS3 into the decomposition of there's some problem with I say it in words because this is 2 square, this is the dimension. Well, I would like to write it. Decomposition. Let's write like this, n equal to 3, yes, so you have that this decomposition is sum of into 3 irreducible representations, so one, and this corresponds to the 3 different partitions of 3, which are 1 plus 1 plus 1, 2 plus 1, and 3 as a whole. So, so the decomposition is 1 plus 1 plus 1, will correspond 1 such model. I draw here the I draw only the diagrams. This is 1 plus 1 plus 1. This is 1 plus 2 plus 1. And the row with 3 boxes will be 3. So the decomposition of S3 will have in it 3 irreducible models. One with such diagram, but not only one, but 2 of them with this space for the multiplicity is it's coming from the multiplicity or and the number depends on the standard tableau. And here this is J plus. So you have one one-dimensional space plus two two-dimensional spaces plus one one-dimensional spaces, and this gives you the right sum. Well, I'm not sure that it's... I hope you got it.
Did you? Yes.
Okay. So for this is also manifestation of the fact that in the group algebra any reducible representation appears with multiplicity which is equal to its dimension. You see that the multiplicity is equal to dimension to the dimension of every such one. So we have and I don't know, I see that I'm drawing quite lengthy with all that. But maybe here to ask for some questions. So can you see that this point here is a best application of the double centralized theorem? So last time we had this general stuff which was written in this A and B theorem, and now you can apply when A and B and Q are just the group algebra. So you take the group algebra, you consider it as a left and a right module. So you take the regular representation. And then when you apply this scheme for the regular representation, you ask what is the centralizer, and you get such a decomposition. And the centralizer is strangely equivalent to the group algebra, only you take different order of the elements, so it's isomorphic up to the order of multiplication. So this situation is highly symmetric, and it demonstrates many properties of the group algebra, so I thought that it would be a good example of this more general theorem. So shall I keep going or tell me?
I think maybe we can end for here, and then we can continue from here the next time, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah. So I guess it gives them time to review the material and go over it. Yeah.
And send you some of this. And yeah, of course, if you have questions, I'm ready to answer.
So, do you have any questions to ask?
Okay.
Yeah, I think because the material was more accessible today.